Hello friends, I hope you are enjoying our video and preparing well. So today we will analyze the Hindu of 24th January. The Hindu of 24th January. So on the first page there is a news that PM calls for protectionism as dangerous as terrorism. Now see, recently the Prime Minister Mr. Narendra Modi is on the tour of Davos to attend the meeting of World Economic Forum, and he said that the world should come together and the major economies should come together and not lead towards the protectionism like America First or having high tariff duty or non-tariff barrier like capping of imports etc. And it is as dangerous as terrorism because obviously it also hampers the world economy growth and prosperity and not giving a fair chance to the developing nation, and particularly undermining the efforts of the multilateral institutions like WTO etc. However, this face value is not very much important, but the core value regarding World Economic Forum is important from the prelims point of view. So we will see a little bit about World Economic Forum, because the Prime Minister is the second such Prime Minister to attend the meeting of World Economic Forum after 20 years, because previously in 1997 Mr. S.D. Dev Gowda had attended the meeting. So the World Economic Forum was established in 1971 as the name of European Management Forum. It is a non-profit organization based in Geneva, although it has regional office in New York, Beijing also, Geneva, Switzerland. It's every year there is an annual meeting at Davos, and it focuses mainly on political and economic issues around the world. Apart from that, this year's theme, since all these are very much important from the prelims point of view, that's why we need to discuss it. This year the 2018 theme was creating a shared future in a fractured world. So this is the theme. Another important point from the prelims point of view. However, the more important things are the reports, because in the UPSC prelims, they usually ask about the report and which institute publish it. So we need to know about the reports which are being published by the World Economic Forum. So the reports. Now, the reports are Global Competitiveness Report, published by World Economic Forum. The second one is Global Gender Gap Report. The third one is Global Travel and Tourism Report. The fourth one is Global Enabling Trade Report. So, and the last one is Global Information Technology Report. So all these reports are very significant from the prelims point of view, because in the examination usually they ask that which of the following is published by World Economic Forum, or either they will give you the name of the report and ask that which institute publishes, whether WEF or World Bank or IMF or WTO, etc. So you need to remember that what are the reports being published by World Economic Forums. So these are very significant information from the examination point of view. Apart from that, there is nothing important on the first page. Then on the national page, there is a news regarding the drawbacks of the scheme of INSPIRE. We have already discussed about the scheme of INSPIRE in our previous lectures. It had also come in the news few days ago, so we had discussed, but still today also we will see a little bit about the scheme. It is basically saying that it has not reached to its desirable outcome, and the level of fellowship is low, and the research oriented career is much lower. So what about the scheme? So the INSPIRE scheme is basically the innovation in science pursuit for inspired research. Now see, this is, the scheme was first conceived in 2008 but launched in 2011. The scheme does not recognize, doesn't need or recognize any entrance exam, entrance test for scientific research. However, it gives weightage to only existing academic framework. Academic framework meaning thereby existing school education, higher secondary, college level education and higher education, etc. Then there are three subsections to attract people into the research and development field for the pursuit of science and to have a career in the research and development. So first one is SEEDS, meaning thereby a scheme for early attraction of talent. This is basically done at the school level. So early attraction of talent, name was SEEDS. Second is C, meaning thereby a scheme for higher education. And the third one is AORC, assured opportunity in research career. So these three are the schemes under INSPIRE, and based on that fellowship is given, and from here, based on this fellowship, they are given an assured career in research field. So this was the scheme. However, there are various issues regarding the dispersal of fund, etc. But the scheme was important from the examination point of view, and that's why one of the benefit of the scheme is that those fellow can be appointed as the professors in the higher educational institutions like IITs, etc. So that is a welcome feature of the scheme. Then see, on the editorial page. The second editorial is regarding the world economy, which is not very much important from the examination point of view. The first article is purely political regarding the election in Karnataka, also not important from the examination point of view. There is an editorial, Reform with Caution. It is basically dealing with the Malimath committee report, but saying that the government should proceed with caution. So a little bit about Malimath committee, because suppose in prelims they ask Malimath committee reports to or relates to Malimath committee, which was formulated in 2003, is based on the criminal justice system. Criminal justice system. Now see, what are the issues in criminal justice system in India? So obviously criminal justice system is facing lot of challenges. For example, delay in persecution. Then nexus between police and criminals. Then corruption in investigation stage. Then a slow trial and delay in justice. All these erodes faith in justice delivery system. And at present, nearly our prison is overcrowded because of delayed justice system, and nearly about 2/3 prisoners are under trial, meaning thereby they have not been sentenced so far, but they are still under prison. So all these are issues in, and obviously because of overcrowded, the basic amenities or facilities and right to life affects of the prisoners, because right to life applies also to the prisoners. So the Malimath committee gave 158 recommendations, and obviously all these recommendations are not important from the examination point of view. Now the government is revisiting all these recommendations to make a part of law. For example, in the case of rape or atrocities on women, some recommendations have been adopted and the definition of rape have been made wider, etc. Harsher punishment have been provided. But some of the recommendations are very having the far-reaching consequence. For example, one of the recommendations is that up to nowadays, the confession made before a police personnel is not admissible in the court of law, because obviously police use various torture methods, etc., and therefore the confession may be under pressure. So the report says that in order to make a speedy faster investigation and trial, a confession made before a person of the rank of superintendent of police and above should be admissible in the court of law. Admissible in court of law. But however, this is a controversial provision, because obviously SP is a very powerful person. He can also pressurize. Suppose, for example, there is a pressure from the politician, etc., or a mafia, etc. So the SP may pressurize to confess to the criminal, etc. The second thing is that it said that the police custody should be increased from 50 to 30 days. Now see, again, it is a controversial provision, because this 30-day period is too much to extract, to pressurize the person, or even more and more torture can be inflicted on the person. So his rights will be violated. Then all these issues are having far-reaching consequences, and that's why it is saying that obviously there is a need to get the speedy trial, etc., and also the restoring the faith of common people in judiciary. But still government should go slow and remain cautious about the impact of the reforms proposed by the Malimath committee. So obviously if anything significant happens, we will see in due course of time. So till now this was just in the news, and that's why we discussed here. There is an article regarding the road safety amendment bill. Although it's in the bill stage, has been passed by the Lok Sabha but not passed in the Rajya Sabha. So once it becomes the act, then we will see about the various provisions regarding the Road Safety Act. However, there are some issues which has been mentioned here, and also we need to understand little bit about the road safety issues in India. So see, in India, road safety remains a challenge. Road safety remains a challenge, and every year, near around 140,000 people die because of road accident, and a large number of them are children below the age of 18 years. There are cases of drunk driving, then over speeding, then lack of safety protocols like no use of helmets, then breaking the signals, etc. Also, there are potholes on the road, then poor design of roads, and also highways are very unsafe because of too much congestion, because highways constitute only 4% of the road network but carries 40% of the total traffic. So most of the accidents occur at highway, so we need to identify the hot spot of highway. And also there was a declaration important from the prelims point of view, particularly declaration called Brasilia Declaration, which relates to reducing the number of death by 50% in road accident by 2020. India is a signatory of this declaration and is committed to bring down the number of deaths, and also it was organized by World Health Organization in 2015. So important from the prelims point of view. Brasilia declaration relates to road safety, organized by WHO in 2015. So the article is basically saying that the proposed, because see, till now we have Motor Vehicles Act of 1988, which is old, and it doesn't cause deterrence for the violators. Motor Vehicles Act 1988, but it is old and not creating deterrence for violators. So government proposed the new bill named Road Safety Bill, introduced in 2016, amended in 2017. Amendment Bill 2017, through which a stricter penalty on the violations, for example, drunk driving, then over speeding, and also in case of repeated violators, their driving license can be cancelled. There will be a centralized database, because all the driving licenses will be issued as centralized database, meaning thereby a violator of Delhi, if violates again in Bangalore, then also the police can access his previous record and then he can be violated. Apart from that, there are provisions for the safety of children. In particular, there is a dedicated road safety fund will be created for the accident victim. Also, there is provision for a centralized regulator called Road Safety Board at the central level. So all these are significant provisions of the Road Safety Amendment Bill. However, whenever the bill becomes act, we will see all the provisions in detail and its pros and cons. Apart from that, on the next page, there is an interview of former Chief Economic Advisor regarding the economic issues, etc. His personal views are not very much important from the examination point of view. He has read some doubt regarding the implementation of goods and services tax and demonetization, its pros and cons. He has said that the Overnight we cannot become a digital society or less cash economy, but it's a gradual process, etc. Because many of the people are living in the rural area where internet connectivity is poor, digital literacy is not low, and GST has also called a dent on the export, etc. So all these are his personal view, but still this is not very much important from the examination point of view. Then on the next page, obviously the Aadhaar debate is going on in the Supreme Court, but once the judgment will come, we will see it. Now only what is called debates are going on because of the litigations, etc. There is a news that SAARC can learn from ASEAN experience. Now see, obviously it is saying that when ASEAN was formed in 1967, the challenges before the ASEAN was very similar to those of SAARC. Challenges were nearly similar to those of SAARC because every member were not of the same potential or same opportunity, but the continued dialogue made it possible to bring all the countries closer. So the continued dialogue is the only process through which SAARC can also get affected, because the interview is basically saying that the connectivity between intra-regional group, particularly for example South Asia through SAARC, is very much important for the regional prosperity, and whatever the issues between India and Pakistan is there should be resolved peacefully bilaterally, so that the overall South Asia region could prosper, and it could only be done through the continued dialogue. So that is the issue has been raised here. Apart from that, it is saying that obviously the mutual distrust, etc., are harming the problem, harming the development of a closer relationship, and saying that the bigger countries, larger countries like India in case of SAARC should give way to smaller countries like Nepal, Bhutan, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, etc., to have their say in the decision making, so that the trust of these countries could grow and they would come closer to India in the SAARC. Also saying, just very next to that, India-ASEAN cultural ties are living link, Sushma Swaraj. Now see, in case of ASEAN region, which is a 10 member block of Southeast Asia, except Vietnam, we had an ancient cultural link. Meaning thereby that Buddhism made its road to Southeast Asia, Myanmar, Thailand, etc., Malaysia. Then also the Shailendra dynasty was having trade with Chola Kingdom of Tamil Nadu. Then the first temple was built not in India but in Cambodia. The Indonesia is having its royal emblem as Garuda symbol as the royal emblem. So all these are our cultural link, and based on this, because despite having poor connectivity between India and ASEAN countries, still the cultural link should be revived so that the people-to-people contact and better coordination could take place. Apart from that, there is also a news that India should not hamper the process of RCEP, Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, meaning thereby ASEAN plus 10 member of ASEAN and 6, yesterday we already discussed, India, China, South Korea, Japan, Australia and New Zealand. So all the members are eager to conclude an early solution to the RCEP, but Ambassador is saying that India's apprehension for the trade deficit with China, and in case of a free trade agreement it is going to rise, should not be given too much speculation, because to gain long-term economic growth, the short-term pain has to be taken. So, whenever any significant things happen over RCEP, we will surely discuss that. Apart from that, on the next page, that is world page, there is a news that Donald Trump administration has raised the tariff duty on washing machine and solar panel, which is hurting South Korea as well as China. And both have said that they will move to the World Trade Organization against the decision of the Trump administration of unfair trade practices or distorting trade practices or not giving the MFN most favored nations treatment to its allies. And also, South Korea is an important ally of USA in the Korean Peninsula. So the issue was little bit of significance. However, from our examination point of view, it is just an example of protectionism and nothing else. Then there is a news on the economy page that in the budget, the industry body has demanded that the corporate tax should be lowered. Obviously, when the NDA regime came into power in 2014, it promised that the corporate tax will be lowered to such a level that it will boost investment. So the issue of corporate tax in India, corporate tax, it is at present is 30%, which is considered high, and therefore it dampens investment and jobs. Because lack of investment, lack of capacity enhancement, and therefore lack of jobs. So the industry body has demanded to lower it down, and also government is saying that even the 30% rate is there, but the overall tax collection due to several concessions like CSR activities, etc., several concessions leads to merely 23% rate of tax collection. So suppose the government has estimated that up to 30% rupee 100 will be collected, then only 23%, meaning thereby that whatever the 30% of rupee 100, the 23% has only been collected. So now the government is saying that it is going to make a flat rate of 25% corporate tax, which is a direct tax, without concession. So no concession, pay directly 25%, because government is also losing revenue on account of several concessions, and corporate is also facing higher taxation, and therefore it leads to lack of investment and jobs. So the government is saying that we will make it 25%, and in the previous budget, government already made 25% tax, corporate tax, on companies having less than 50 crore annual turnover. So obviously we will see in this budget what the government is going to do. Whenever any significant news comes, you will see that. Then there is a news regarding Japan for greater ties with India in food processing. Obviously, our economic ties with Japan is very much important. So, Japan having better technology, particularly in the area of electronics, robotics, high speed train, etc. India has manpower, particularly in the field of IT, pharmaceuticals industries, etc. So the Japan is saying that we can come closer in the various fields, for example, food processing industry. Japan is already building Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor. Then bullet train on Mumbai Ahmedabad route on a very soft rate of interest, then it is also helping in smart cities to build Varanasi, Chandigarh, etc. Apart from that, we are already part of Quad, India, Japan, Australia and US. So it is saying that obviously India should facilitate and ease the infrastructural problems and should facilitate creation of dedicated Japanese industrial park, etc. to boost the Japanese investment into India, because Japan has technology as well as surplus wealth. So it needs the area of investment. India needs all the investment in relevant section. Then it is also saying that the issue of water management, sanitation, etc. should also be covered under Japan's investment. Apart from that, there is nothing significant on the economy page. So with this, we come to the end of analysis of the Hindu of 24 January. So if you have any doubt, you can ask in the comment section, or you can also send mail on easylearning.dr@gmail.com. So kindly like, subscribe and share our channel, and also give your feedback. Thank you.